Hello, and welcome to episode 4 of my First Reef Aquarium. In the previous episodes, we set up our tank, complete with live rock, substrate, and salt water. In this episode, we cycle the tank, which means that we mostly sit back and monitor a natural biological process called the nitrogen cycle. FYI, this is a short episode, but an extremely important one for the success of your future reef, so listen up. The nitrogen cycle takes place in both saltwater and freshwater environments. First, marine organisms produce organic waste, and that waste dissolves and releases ammonia, which in large enough quantities is fatal. Then, aerobic bacteria that grow in the substrate in rocky beds convert this ammonia into less harmful nitrite, and later on, to non-toxic nitrate. Now, nitrate is food for nuisance algae. So unless the nitrate levels go down, you can expect an algae outbreak. Fortunately, colonies of denitrifying bacteria grow in the deeper areas of the substrate and rocks, and they convert the nitrate into harmless nitrogen gas, which leaves the aquarium. In a newly set reef system, this whole cycle takes about 8 weeks, sometimes even more. And only when it's done is there enough beneficial bacteria in the water to start introducing the livestock. However, with the help of starter kits, such as Red Sea's Reef Mature, we can wrap up the cycle in less than a month. After we have filled our aquarium with water for the first time, we turn on the return pump and lighting, and proceed by following Reef Mature's very simple and detailed instructions. We start by supplementing with a bit of nitrogen and phosphate compounds, as well as elements that enhance the growth of the denitrifying bacteria hidden inside the substrate in live rocks. Do not attempt to hasten or jumpstart the cycle by adding a small piece of food, as the ammonia released by even a little shrimp, for example, is far more than your tank can handle. Continue to supplement each day according to the instructions and let nature run its course. On day 10, we introduce a cleaning crew to the aquarium, or in other words, algae-eating invertebrates, such as Fusaria snail, turbo snails, trocha snail, and hermit crab. These janitors play an important long-term role, keeping the substrate clean and aerated, and helping to control algae, remove detritus, and scavenge for scraps of food that fall to the bottom or between rocks. On day 14, we begin introducing fish, which should preferably belong to a resilient algae-eating species. We add one fish for every 100 liters or 26.4 gallons of water. This tank contains 100 liters, so we introduce one fish. In the following days, we keep a close eye on them and make sure they're healthy and happy. During the entire cycling period, we will experience algae blooms. Initially, brown diatom algae will appear, followed by red cyanobacteria, and then green filamentous algae. These algae blooms will disappear on their own, giving way to patches of desirable purple-pink coralline algae on the live rocks. During this period, we will also test the water parameters on a daily basis, keep a record, and make quick adjustments if necessary. Our goal is to make sure that the pH and salinity levels remain stable, while monitoring the ammonia and nitrite. In the beginning, there should be a spike in the ammonia level, which will peak, then start declining until it reaches zero. Then we should see a spike in the nitrite level, which will also peak and decline until it reaches zero. When the nitrite reaches zero, we will be done with the tank cycling. A word on test kits. Testing water parameters is something you continuously do in this hobby, so it is important to use highly accurate test kits. At this stage though, simpler marine test kits will do. Now that all our water parameters are where they should be, we slowly start introducing more fish and then corals. But all of that takes place in our next episode, so see you there.